Alhamdulillah, we are here to reflect upon Al-Mi'raj Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I quote to you what Qadi Ayyad rahmatullahi mentions, or Mullah Ali Qari mentions it in his Sharra, his commentary of Imam Qadi Ayyad's famous Shifa. He said that from all the miracles that Allah bestowed upon the Prophet sallam, from every miracle that he gave his beloved, the biggest of the miracles was the Quran al-Kareem. This Kitab Allah, this Kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which does not resemble no words, no letters, no sound. This honorable book that Allah sent to His Prophet. This was the biggest miracle Allah bestowed to His Messenger, to His Beloved. The greatest of all the miracles. From every miracle you put together, the greatest of those miracles was this book, because Allah said, we will preserve it. Yani we will not leave the preservation of the Quran in your hands. And then you have the miracles of the Prophet that he was able to feed people with a little, a small amount of water. For example, we have the hadith when he called Abu Huraira and he said, come here Abu Huraira. He said, I've got milk for you. Drink. He said, before you drink, bring everyone. And Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu says to himself that when I heard that, I looked at the milk and I thought, what am I going to get? He says, a bit of selfishness came in me, but I don't want to use that word because it's not really a suitable word. He said, I thought maybe I'll get no drink. He said, every Sahabi came and every companion came and he drank the water, he drank the milk to the fullest. They drank and they drank and they drank. And then Abu Huraira's thinking each time, what will be left for me? He said, when it came to my turn, I drank the milk. He said, wallahi, I drank and it never ended. Yani this was a miracle of the Prophet. And then we have the miracle that he was able to cure people. And we know he was able to raise the dead. Yani Imam Al-Qastalani rahmatullahi in his Sharra of Al-Bukhari, he says that the miracles that Allah bestowed upon the Prophet, he says in totality they were greater than any miracle given to any of the Prophet. He said Allah took the miracles of all the Prophets and he made them into such a type that he bestowed them into the Prophet. So for example, we have the greatest of the miracles, which is what yani the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was able to what, speak to the dead. That he was able to go and he was able to raise the dead. There's many hadith that confirm this. And that is why there's a very famous incident in the seerah in which Aisha radiallahu anha, she remembers something. And she says, it's in the Shama'il of Muhammadiyah, or Shama'il al-Tirmidhi by Imam al-Tirmidhi. It's a very famous book which you all should buy and you should read, al-Shama'il. It describes the Prophet's attitude, his character, how he walked, how he sat, how he ate, sallallahu alayhi salatu wasalam. She said that wallahi, when the women of Zulaika saw Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, when they saw Yusuf, this beautiful man, when this hijab was removed, and I've mentioned this before, when this hijab was removed, the women of Zulaika, they immediately, when they saw Yusuf, that sight intoxicated them, it took over their nervous system and they were cutting their fingers and they were not able to feel the pain. Because when they saw this beauty of a prophet, Yusuf alayhi salam, yani there's a hadith in we have, on Yom Al-Qiyamah, your face will be like Yusuf. If you go Jannah and you are guaranteed Jannah, inshallah we will all be, your face will be like Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Every character you have will be unique to a prophet. Aisha says that when they saw this person, when the women of Zulaika saw Yusuf, they began to cut their fingers. She said, wallahi, if they would have just seen the beauty of the Prophet, they would have cut open their hearts. This was the beauty. And that is why Mulla Ali Qari rahmatullah alayhi, in his famous commentary on Ash-Shifa Sharif, he says that Allah's, those characteristics which Allah bestowed upon the Prophet, he got all of the Prophet's characteristics. He brought them all together. Every Prophet, whatever characteristic he have or had, he took it from them. And he made it even greater and he put it into the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is why every character, every behavior, every movement of the Messenger of Allah was the best. And Mi'raj Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is one of those things which Sayyid Muhammad al-Makki, Sayyid Muhammad bin Ali al-Makki al-Malik rahmatullah alayhi, Imam al-Haramain rahmatullah alayhi, the great Imam, he said in his book on the Mi'raj, he said that this miracle, from all of the miracles after the Quran, it is the greatest of Allah's miracles to the Prophet sallallahu. Think about it. From every miracle that Allah gave to His Prophet after the Quran, the greatest of the miracles with the Quran. And the Imams, the ulama said something else. They said there is a beauty about this miracle which is not known to people unless you think about it. He said, every miracle the Prophet ﷺ did. Yani, let me first of all define to you what a miracle is. Imam al-Qastalani and Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani radiallahu anhu warda in his Fathul Bari, in his famous comment of Bukhari Sharif, he says, a miracle is a challenge to humanity. A miracle is that which cannot be accomplished by man by himself. A miracle is that which goes against the laws of physics and logic and reason. And it goes beyond that, and it is to demonstrate something which is not normal. And he said, a miracle, a mu'jiza, is that which only a prophet can do. Al-mu'jiza is something which only the prophets can do. No one other than the prophets can do. And he said, it is that which challenges people, and it is that which people will never be able to achieve. Now, every miracle the Prophet ﷺ had, you remember the miracle of Prophet Ismail ﷺ? He kicked the flu and water came out. It came from the earth, not from his body. Do we agree? What about the Messenger of Allah ﷺ? Look how Allah honored him. The water did not come from the floor, the water came from his body. You see the difference? One is water coming from the floor, and one is water coming from your body. And the Sahaba began drinking from it. The Sahaba began doing wudu with it. All these miracles, look at him. Look at the miracle of the Prophet ﷺ. In every sense, all of these miracles, look at the example, the miracle when Al-Quraysh challenged him and he split the moon into two halves. Look at the miracles when Abu Jahl came to him. And Abu Jahl said to him, Ya Muhammad, O Muhammad, O Abul Qasim, what do you have in your hand? He said, what I have in my hand will tell you who I am. And he opened the hand and the stone said, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. Whenever he walked, the animals came to him and did sijda to him. You know, the tree, if there was a tree in his way, the tree would rip its roots open and move away just to give way to the Messenger of Allah. This is what you call VIP treatment. Real VIP treatment. Now let me ask you one thing. All of these miracles that happened, were they witnessed by people? It's not a tricky question. Yes. All the miracles that took place in Islam, every miracle the Messenger of Allah did, they happened in front of people. Al-Mi'raj Nabi is the only miracle that didn't happen in front of people. And that is why Sayyid Muhammad bin Ali al-Makki al-Maliki says that the Mi'raj Nabi is one of the biggest tests for Iman of that time. And why? Because they say Al-Mi'raj at that time, when did it happen? Al-Mi'raj, according to the narrations we have, Al-Mukhtalif narrations, some say 3 years, which is a very weak opinion, but the most authentic opinion we have is about 18 months before the Hijrah. Now this 18 months before the Messenger of Allah migrated from Mecca to Medina, what was his circumstance like? He was living at what we call the 3 years of sorrow. When Al-Quraysh had abandoned him, Al-Quraysh had boycotted him, financial sanctions against him. You could not buy from him. You could not sell to him. You could not marry him. Everyone, all the Muslims were thrown out of Mecca. During this time, Abu Talib, his uncle, dies. During this time, his honorable and most beloved wife, his rock in his life, his supporter, the most beloved of his supporters, the first person to become a Muslim in Islam, Khadija al-Kubra radiallahu anha warda, the mother of Fatima al-Zahra radiallahu anha, the mother of the offspring of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She passes away. At this time of his life, he feels what? The ulama say it is a time when it is the biggest test to Allah. So to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to honor his messenger, to an honorability, Allah took him to the Mi'raj. Allah gave him a treat. You know a treat you give to someone? At this time, the Sahaba were very emotionally downgraded in the sense that they were emotionally affected with the traumas that were happening at that time. And in the midst of all of this, what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? He took his beloved and he showed him that which he has not shown to anyone. And he will never show to anyone ever before. Even after that. Remember this. The things which the Messenger of Allah witnessed beyond Sidratul Muntaha, to Lamakan, to the place, all of these beautiful creations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will never see them. And no one after you will ever see them. This was restricted only for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the objective of this was what the ulama said. It was not to bring the Prophet's iman up. That's kufr. We don't believe that. The objective of al-mi'raj was to put iman and to test the iman of the sahaba. That is the reason. Sayyid Muhammad bin Ali al-Makki al-Maliki says that the mi'raj Nabi was not. It did not happen because Allah wanted to test his Prophet. Yani, وَمَا يَنْتِكُ عَنِ الْحَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٍ يُحَىٰ. Muhammad does not speak from his desire, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٍ يُحَىٰ. He only speaks from revelation from Allah. They said the reason, the ultimate reason of Al-Mi'raj was to re-evaluate the iman of the Sahaba. Was to show and to prove who is a believer and who isn't from them. رَضْوَانَ اللَّهُمْ عَلَيْهِمْ أَجْمَعِينَ. It is to re-evaluate and say to the people who believes and who does not believe. And Al-Mi'raj Nabi, we divide it, or it is divided between two areas. What is what we call Al-Isra and what is what we call Mi'raj. But Al-Mi'raj Nabi is that miraculous journey that there is no distinction or difference between any Muslim. What do I mean? I mean, if you fail or if you refuse to believe in Al-Mi'raj Nabi, you become a non-Muslim. If you deny the Mi'raj, if you say and you deny that the Prophet did not go on Al-Mi'raj in his body sense, physically, not sleep, physically he did not go there with his soul, you become a non-Muslim. Al-Mi'raj Nabi is amongst what we call al-Zuriyat al-Din. It is amongst those which are the necessities of your deen. And it is for that reason Imam al-Tahawi, in his al-Tahawi, in his Tahawi, Imam Abu Ja'far Ahmad bin Muhammad al-Tahawi, rahmatullahi, who died in the year 321 after Hijri, a very famous scholar of the Hanafi school, he said, "Wal mi'raju haq." He said, "The mi'raj is haq, it is truth, it happened." "Wal mi'raju haqqun. وقد أسري بالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وعرج بشخصه في اليخاضة إلى السماء ثم إلى حيث شاء الله تعالى من العلا وأكرمه الله تعالى بما شاء فأوحى إلى عبده ما أوحى ما كذب الفؤاد ما رأى فصلى الله عليه وسلم في الآخرة والأولى." Imam al-Tahawi says that the Mi'raj, the Prophet's journey to the heavens, it is a haq, it is a reality, it happened, it is a truth. He says the Prophet ﷺ, he was taken by night and he ascended to the heavens in his bodily, and he was awake, he was not asleep, and he went through the heavens and he witnessed whatever he witnessed and he saw whatever he saw, or whatever Allah willed. And Allah honored him in that what he willed. And Allah revealed to him what he revealed. And he said, and his heart was not mistaken about what he saw. Surah Najm. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed him. Also, for another point, to show that Al-Mi'raj Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not what we call something which is light. It is something which you have to believe in. Another very famous scholar, Imam Abu Hafs, Umar bin Muhammad al-Nasafi rahmatullah alayhi, who wrote the book Al-Aqaid al-Nasafi, a very famous poem. He died in the year 537 after Hijri. A very famous Imam in Islam, the Hanafi school specifically. He wrote and he said that the Prophet's night, Mi'raj, the Prophet's ascension was by bodily, and his journey was in a wakeful state to the heavens and then to the heights where Allah wished. And it is by muttafaqun alayhi that any Muslim who does not believe in this, any Muslim that refuses to believe in this, he falls out of the fold of Islam. And it is that miracle which Allah bestowed upon the Prophet which was not witnessed by anyone. Remember, every miracle was witnessed. When he, when water came out of his honorable hands, it was witnessed. When he, when he struck something, it was witnessed. When he, when he leaned across against the tree would speak to him. In fact, that tree, when he went to the minbar, the tree began to complain, "Why have you left me, Ya Rasulullah?" And many narrations, you have, for example, his camel. They say his camel, after the Prophet passed away, 12 months later he passed away, out of sadness. And that 12 months of his life, the camel was like, it did not want to live. It was so miserable, because he has lost his companion, his honorable rider, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Al-Mi'raj Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is that, and what is the importance of this, Al-Mi'raj Nabi? Al-Mi'raj Nabi, and remember, every prophet was given a certain quality to bring them, to bring their people back to Tawheed, to teach people Tawheed. Every messenger that came, over 124,000 narrations, as any prophets we have. One narration said we have over 300,000 prophets that were sent to mankind. And every prophet that was sent, he was sent with only one objective. What was the objective? To teach Tawheed. La ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah. Fa'alam annahu la ilaha illallah. To bring people back to Tawheed. What is Tawheed? Tawheed is believing in the uniqueness of Allah, that nothing is like Him. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is unique. Nothing is like Him. Nothing is similar to Him. He does not sit. He does not walk. He does not eat. He does not have eyes. He does not have ears. He He doesn't have a mouth. He does not speak. Allah is not need of place or time like you and me are. And this was the message. And then the messenger of Allah came. And the greatest of these miracles after the Quran, as I've mentioned to you already, was the miracle of Al-Mi'raj. Every hadith that was narrated by the Mi'raj, and in total, Imam Ibn Kathir and Imam Al-Zahabi mentioned that there were in total 42 Sahaba narrated the incident of Al-Mi'raj. 42 Sahaba. He said from these 42 Sahaba, every narration goes back to two companions. So there were 42 Sahaba that narrated the incident of Al-Mi'raj Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But from these 42 Sahaba, only two of them were the main narrators who every Sahaba went back to. Abu Dhar Al-Ghifari radiallahu anhu warda, the great Sahabi, and the second Sahabi is Malik ibn Sa'at Al-Ansari radiallahu anhu warda. These were the two companions. So for example, even if you open Al-Bukhari Sharif, and if you go to the chapter, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, if you go to the chapter of the manaqib of the Ansar, the chapter of the biographies of the people from an Ansar, there is a specific chapter on Mi'raj Nabi, very small, maybe five hadith in there, three hadith. And in that hadith, if you read the narration in Arabic, you will see that the hadith is narrated by, if I'm correct, by Anas ibn Malik, radiallahu anhu warda. And Anas says, radiallahu anhu warda, I heard a hadith from Malik ibn Sa'asa. So every hadith that was narrated, all the Sahaba, you have Anas ibn Malik, Abu Huraira, you have, for example, Ibn Umar, you have, for example, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu warda, even all of these Sahaba, all of them narrated the hadith, all of them narrated these 42 hadith, all these 42 Sahaba narrated all of the hadith from these two companions. And based upon this, it is muttafaqun alayhi, it is agreed upon all the Imams of Islam, whether Shi'i, Sunni, Wahhabi, anyone, doesn't matter who you follow, every Sunni, every Muslim scholar agrees that anyone who denies the Mi'raj falls out of the fold of Islam. And Al-Mi'raj Nabi is a very beautiful journey. But I want to start by quoting you the hadith in Bukhari, which will set the platform for us. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he had a quality, or he had a specific miracle, which was only for him. And that miracle was that when the Prophet sleep, their heart doesn't sleep. Their eyes may be closed, but they are awake. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that one day, it's two narrations, he says, according to Bukhari, he says, that I was sleeping near the Kaaba, one narration says, near the Haram. And the second narration we have is that he was sleeping in one of his houses near the Kaaba. He said, then I was awakened up by Jibreel. Jibreel came to me. Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam came to me. And Jibreel, according to a second narration, Mikael alayhi salatu wasalam came. Two angels came, Jibreel and Mikael. He said, Jibreel informed me and told me, Ya Rasulullah, it is time for you to visit Allah. It is time for you now to visit Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Jibreel said to me, follow me. And the Prophet walked with him and they went to Zamzam. When they arrived at Zamzam, the Prophet said that Jibreel opened my chest. He opened my chest. The narration says from my throat all the way to the bottom. He said then he put his honorable hand into his honorable body, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Jibreel took out his heart, the Prophet's heart. Jibreel then asked Mikael to bring some Zamzam. And Zamzam water was brought in a gold, pure gold, beautiful cup or glass or plate, according to the narrations. The Prophet said that my honorable heart or his heart, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was put into the plate and it was washed. It was given a ghusl. And it was put back into his honorable body. A point to note here that Mullah Ali Qari mentions. He said that when we said that his heart was washed, in what sense? That Allah honored him. It wasn't to say that he had impurity in him. Anyone that believes that the Prophet ﷺ had any form of impurity in him is a kafir. Anyone that believes that the Prophet ﷺ had any form of even a slight type of dirt on him, in any sense, is a kafir. Immediately. There's no doubt upon it, upon all ulama. Let me mention to you one point. Imam Razi says in his Wadduha, in his Tafsir al-Kabir, on the commentary of Wadduha wal-layli idha saja, he gave an analogy. Imam Razi kya firmate, that you are walking, a lace on the floor, a shoelace. That shoelace never touched the Prophet's body. No. It only touched the feet, it only touched the sandals of the Prophet. Yani a shoeless on the floor, that shoeless only touched the sandals of the Prophet, not his feet. Imam Razi says, if you show disrespect to a shoeless, you automatically become a kafir. Yani the shoeless, if there's a shoeless on the floor, and that shoeless in any way just touched the sandals, not the person's feet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, just his sandals, Imam Razi says that he becomes a kafir. That is why when the angels came and they took his honorable, beautiful, most noble heart out of his most honorable and most perfect body, it was not in need to yani to purify, because he's already purified. Every prophet is purified by definition. Even before they announced the prophethood. It is an agreement by all the ulama. Every prophet, Musa, Isa, every prophet, even when he was born, he's pure. You look at every prophet when they were born, they were pure. They were never impure. The ulama said the reason why the heart was taken out of his honorable body, Imam Arumi from Ate, the reason why this heart was taken out was for what reason? Was to do his ta'zeem, was to accelerate him, to show to humanity, this is my Habibi, this is how much I love him. It wasn't to try to purify him, because he's already purified. He is the best of creation. He is the reason for creation. No one is similar to him. He is the king of the kings. He is the one that nothing can compare to him. Nothing is like him. The reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered it, and look, he never ordered any angels. He sent him Jibreel and he sent him Mikael. He said, two of my best angels, go to my beloved. And when you go to my beloved, greet him. And when you go to my beloved, I give you the blessings of taking and having his honorable heart in your hands. And this happens. The Prophet ﷺ says what? And this is a beautiful incident which Qadi Ayad mentions in his Shifa Sharif, in his introduction of a Shifa Sharif. Qadi Ayad says, Rahmatul Alayhi, Qadi Ayad is a 7th century Maliki Imam. He is one of the greatest Imams of his time. In fact, Qadi Ayad Rahmatul Alayhi wrote the most famous commentary on Sahih Muslim Sharif. And if you read Imam An-Nawawi's commentary, it is like an addition to Imam Qadi Ayad's version. Imam Nawawi, throughout his Sharra Sharif, in his Sharra of Sahih Muslim, he's every time quoting Qadi Ayad. Anyway, Qadi Ayad, he wrote a book called Ash-Shifa Sharif, Ash-Shifa. And Ash-Shifa is a book he wrote. What is it? It is a book that describes to you the Prophet's honorable characteristics. How you should love him, how you should honor him and his rights. In the Qadi Ayad, he mentions a beautiful hadith. He says on the night of Miraj, on Al-Isra, because we talk about the first journey, from Mecca to Jerusalem. This journey is called Al-Isra. You're going, it's going across. He said that on this night, Jibreel came to me and he brought Al-Buraq to me. He brought this creature to me. It was similar to like a horse or a donkey or a mule, but it wasn't the same size. It had wings on him. Unbelievable. Anyway, Al-Buraq is brought and Jibreel said, Ya Rasulullah, climb and sit on Al-Buraq. Sit. And when the Prophet ﷺ attempted to sit on Al-Buraq, he began to move. Agitated. He began to move. When Jibreel saw him doing this, Jibreel said to him, what? Look at the beauty. But Jibreel says, Abi Muhammad and taf'alu hada? You dare do this to the Messenger of Allah? You dare do this to Muhammad Rasulullah? He says, Fama rakiba ahadun akrama Allahu minhu. Allahu Akbar. Jibreel says to him, no one more honorable has ever ridden you than him. He's the most honorable of Allah's creation. Look at it. He says, Fama rakiba ahadun akrama Allahu minhu. That the most honorable, yani Jibreel said, that the most honorable of Allah's creation has never, nothing has ever ridden you more honorable than him. You dare do this? You dare move around? And immediately what did Al-Buraq do? He says, Farfadda araqa. Al-Buraq, it melted. And immediately began to smet. It broke down out of smet. Sweet smet. Like he's been told a lesson. And Al-Buraq, from that time, the Messenger of Allah, he went on Al-Buraq. And it was an animal which was extremely, very quick. Yani wherever it could look, that's where his feet went. Yani beyond the laws of physics, it is not something which is unimaginable. Anyway, the Prophet says that I got on Al-Buraq and I traveled with Jibreel. He said, we come to a land, and this land that we come to, it has green palm trees or palm trees. The Prophet said, I came off and Jibreel said to me, Ya Rasulullah, pray two rakat here. And the Prophet prayed two rakat. He says, after he prayed, Jibreel said to him, Ya Rasulullah, do you know where you are now? And the Prophet said, Allahu wa Rasulu alam. Allah and his Prophet, Allah and his Messenger, Jibreel know best. And Jibreel said to him, this is this place that you've come to, it is called Taiba. And Taiba was one of the names of Medina Sharif. Look at the beauty. The Prophet had not migrated to Medina. The Prophet had not gone to Medina Sharif. He's still in Mecca. 18 months later, he's going to make this migration. There's no indication he's going to go to Medina Sharif. And Al-Buraq, Jibreel, brings the message of Allah and says, pray two rakat here. Another beautiful point to note here is the Prophet's mother's side were from Medina Sharif. And the Prophet's grandfather, Abdul Muttalib, he was born in Medina Sharif. He wasn't born in Mecca, he was born in Medina Sharif. And at that time it was called Yathrib. And then the Prophet said that then Jibreel told me to sit on Al-Buraq, and I sat. And we continued our journey. He said, we continued going to a journey, and then we stopped again. And Jibreel told me to pray two rakats, and I did it. And again Jibreel said to me, do you know where you are, Ya Rasulullah? He said, Allahu alam. He said, this is Tur Sina. This is where Musa spoke to Allah. This is where Musa spoke to Allah. And the Prophet got back on Al-Buraq, and they continued journey. And again, they continued journey. And Jibreel, the Prophet says, this is the hadith by the Prophet. He's narrating this incident himself, what's happening to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And you all have to say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Come on. Put nur into your mouth. Put beauty in your mouth. Free, no charge. It is the best cure for any disease you have. Try it. I had a problem with my knee and my ankle. Some issues happened. Wallahi, the best cure is the Durood Sharif. It's the best. That is why ulama write books about al-fadail al-Durood Sharif. Fadail al-salawat upon Prophet. If ever you feel sad, and you youngsters at the back, I'm very happy you've come today again. Jazakallah khairan from last week. You came. This is a lesson for you three at the back. Whenever you feel sad in your life, remember him. Anytime you feel sad, anytime you feel downfall, any musibah happens to you, remember what I told you last week about Ahmed ibn Ajibah said, Ibn Atayla said about the actions of man, they feel that when you rely upon yourself, you feel. Wallahi, whenever you feel sad in your life, remember him. Remember him because he loves you, and he loves you truly, he loves you. And he loves everyone, even Taqir, he loves you, he loves you, he loves every single one of us. And he loves you all, and you three at the back, he loves you more than your mothers love you. Wallahi al-Azim, no doubt. And he knows your name, and he knows who you are. And when you send salawat upon him, he replies back to you using your name. Kitni badi baat hai. Yani not only this, our actions are, you know, our actions are presented to Prophet. I want to come off the point because it's important here. Our actions are presented to him, Prophet. Not only are they presented, what did they say, ulama say? They say that when he sees you do sin, say if I lie, if I cheat, if I hit someone or I do haram, the Prophet will seek forgiveness on my behalf to Allah. Think of which Prophet is that? Which person will that? You tell me. You think I will ask your forgiveness if you did something bad? No, go away, go away. On Yawm al-Qiyamah, every Prophet is worried about himself. But the Prophet said that if you do guna, you cheat, you do haram, major or minor sins, he said, any sin you do, I will seek your forgiveness from Allah. Now let me ask you a question. If I seek forgiveness for you, no value. When the best of creation goes to his beloved, when the beloved asks the beloved, oh Allah, forgive my ummati, don't you think he'll forgive him? Kitni badi baat hai, kitni beautiful. And this is not a daif or mawzu hadith. This is not a weak hadith. This is found in authentic hadith narrated by Ibn Imam al-Bizar in his Musnad Sharif. And the hadith is narrated by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu warda. That is hadith, by any shadow of doubt, it was authentic, similar to Bukhari. The same conditions. And then the Prophet said, I continued. So remember him. Whenever you feel sad, remember him. Don't remember mommy first of all, remember him. Because he is the best. And trust me, when you remember him, and you look upon your mother, you will smile and you will love her even more. Trust me on that. When you remember the messenger of Allah, tears come from your eyes. Have you ever thought, who has been Haram Sharif here? Who has been to Arawzat al-Mubarak? That when you go in front of him, you say, Ya Rasulullah, I'm in front of you, Ya Habibullah. And what happens to you? You cry. Wallah al-Azim, tears come from your eyes. And you don't know why, but you're crying. And you're not ashamed to cry. And you're not crying because you want to show your friend, I'm crying. You're crying because you love him. This is the love of our Messenger of Allah. He says what? He says that then I got back on al-Buraq and I traveled. He said we came to another land. And Jibreel told me to come off and said, Ya Rasulullah, pray 2 rakat. He said, I prayed 2 rakat. After I prayed rakatain, Jibreel said to me, Ya Rasulullah, do you know where you are now? And the Prophet said, Allahu alam, Allah knows best. And Jibreel said to him that this place is Baytul Laham. This is the place where Isa was born. Where Jesus Christ, the son of Mary, the son of Maryam alayhi salam, was born. And then the Prophet, he got back on al-Buraq. And he went and he entered into al-Quds. The Prophet said that when I arrived in al-Baytul Muqaddas, when I arrived in Masjid al-Aqsa, he says al-Buraq descended. He said, I came off al-Buraq and when I looked, I saw many other Buraqs there. Many Buraqs there. Meaning all the prophets, you know, all the prophets are waiting for him now. Yani, this is the message of Allah. Look at it, the welcome you get. Let's say I come to your house, maybe Tokisam, I go to his house, you welcome. Assalamu alaikum. How are you? Fine. No, okay, fine. Now imagine you come and you put a red carpet out and you put flowers and you throw flowers and you shout and you sing and you do salawat upon the Prophet. Imagine you do all of these things. It has a bigger effect. Now the Messenger of Allah is coming to where? Al-Quds. The Prophets know, immediately they all come to Al-Bayt al-Muqaddas. And all of them have tied their buraq or their animals to a place or ring, like a stick part. And the Prophet said that when I came there, I tied my buraq onto the ring that was used by the messengers of Allah for their animals. The Prophet said, after I did this, I entered into the masjid. I walked into the masjid. He said, when I came in the masjid, I saw all the prophets there. From Adam to Isa. All the prophets are all gathered there. Anticipating my arrival. Imagine that. All the prophets are there waiting for the beloved of Allah to come into the masjid. Kitni badi baat hai. Subhanallah. All the prophets are waiting there. They're all sitting there waiting for this honorable creation of Allah, the best of creation to come. And the Prophet said what? He said, I came and I went and led the jama'ah. I went in front and I read the 2 rakat and every prophet prayed behind me. This was what? One of the meaning was to re-emphasize the greatness of the Messenger of Allah. Was to tell you that every prophet is great. It is our belief as Sunni Muslims, or as Muslims, that we do not speak disrespectful about any prophet. Full stop. That is a no-go area. We don't criticize any prophet. Whenever we mention any prophet, we mention it with love. And this is our belief. Every prophet had a great quality. But this incident where all the prophets prayed behind their master, and our master was for one reason. What was that? Was to re-emphasize the ta'zeem of the Messenger of Allah. And the Prophet said, after I did this, I led them in prayer. He says, then what happened? Jibreel took me, and we went to the first heaven. The first narration says that Al-Buraq took us. The second narration we have, which is more authentic, there was a stair, Al-Mirqat. A special stairs, you know stairs you have? And each stair, one was made of gold and silver, and so forth. And the Prophet walked on these honorable stairs until he came to the first heaven. When he arrived at the first heaven, he says that Jibreel asked for a door to be opened. Remember, this door in Jannah, this first door, has never been opened for anyone before the Messenger of Allah. No one. From the day one it was created until Yawm al-Qiyamah, It has never been open for anyone. And Jibreel says, it said, فَقِيلَ مَنْ هَذَا. It said, who are you? And قَالَ, Jibreel said, I am Jibreel. It then said, وَمَنْ مَعَكَ. And who is with you? He says, قَالَ Muhammad. The keeper is saying to Jibreel, who are you? I am Jibreel. He said, okay. He says, مَنْ مَعَكَ. Who is with you? He says, Muhammad. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah. He says, وَقَدْ أُرْسِلَ إِلَيْهِ. He says, is it time for him to come? قَالَ نَعَمْ. He said, yes. And then he said, مَرْحَبًا بِهِ فَنِعْمَ الْمَاجِئُ. He said, he is welcome, and what an excellent visit we have today. What an excellent visit we have, that the Messenger of Allah said, that when I entered in, I saw my father, Adam alayhi salam. Adam, the first human being. He said, I saw him, that he would on his right was some bodies, and on his left was some bodies. When he would look towards his right, he would be happy. And when he would look towards his left, he would be dissatisfied. But before this, when he saw the Messenger of Allah, he said, Marhaban, O my son, my pious son. Marhaban li ibn salih wa nabiyya salih. Welcome, O pious Prophet of Allah. And the Prophet asked Jibreel, he said, why is he upset? He says, because the born, when he looks at the right, when he smiles, these are his offsprings and his descendants that were good believers. And these on the left, that he, when he cried, he was weeping because they did not follow his message or did not become Muslims. This is the unity of humanity. And then the hadith continues and says that we went to the second heaven. And again, the second heaven said, the Jibreel asked for the door to be open. And he said, who are you? Man hadha? He said, Jibreel, man ma'ak, who is with you? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he continued. He said, when I got to the second heaven, and when the door was open, I saw Yahya, the son of Zachariah, and I saw Isa, the son of Maryam. I saw Isa, Jesus Christ, and I saw Zachariah, who were both cousins from the maternal side. And I greeted them. He says, then Jibreel, he took me to the next heaven. And again, the same incident happened again. Who are you? And so forth. He said, when the door was open, and I entered, I saw my brother Idris. Sayyidina Idris alayhi salatu salam. And Sayyidina Idris is the prophet who, after Prophet Adam alayhi salatu salam, he is the first person from Bani Adam or Banu Adam who is a prophet and the prophet's grandfather. The first person in the genealogy. If you study the Prophet's genealogy, Ibn Hisham mentions in detail, the first prophet in that genealogy after Adam alayhi salatu salam was Idris. The prophet said, I came and he greeted me and I went. He said, I continue going. He said, eventually I went to the fifth heaven. He said, when I went to the fifth heaven, again, the door was open and I saw Harun. Prophet Harun. Aaron, they call him in the Old Testament. The brother of Musa. And I greeted him and he welcomed me. He said, then I was taken to the sixth heaven. The sixth heaven. He said, when I came to the sixth heaven, again, Jibreel, the same incident happened again. He knocked on the door, opened the door and so forth. I don't want to go through all of it in detail, you know, in so much, because I want to keep moving. He says, when I got there, I saw Musa alayhi salatu wassalam. And Musa was praying, and when he saw me, he welcomed me. He says, when I left, I saw Musa crying. Prophet Musa alayhi salatu wassalam. I said to Jibreel, why is he crying? He said, Ya Rasulullah, he's crying because when he looks at you, he feels happy that on Yawm al-Qiyamah, more of your followers will enter Jannah than his. He's upset because Bani Israel did not follow his message. He says, then the Prophet said, then I was taken to the seventh heaven. He says, when I went to the seventh heaven, Jibreel said again, open the door. The door was open. Everything was open. He said, the moment it was open, I saw my father Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam. One narration says, I saw Ibrahim and Ismail. And what were they doing? They were worshipping and doing tawaf around Baytul Ma'mur. Baytul Ma'mur. Al-Baytul Ma'mur is the Kaaba in Jannah. Like you have the Kaaba in this dunya, it is the same type of Kaaba in Jannah. The hadith says every day, 70,000 angels will do tawaf around it and go inside it. Every day, 70,000 angels will go around it. And they will never do it again. Every single day. He says after this, Allahu Akbar. He He says, we come to Sidratul Muntaha. In Muslim Sharif Khadisa. He says, we come to Sidratul Muntaha, this beautiful tree. The Prophet said, Sidratul Muntaha, whose leaves were like elephant ears, and its fruits were like big earthenware vessels. And when it was, and it was all covered by the command of Allah, all the zikr of Allah, the leaves and everything were within the command of Allah. He says that when the birds or the flies would fly to this tree, they were made of gold. Jibreel is there. Now the person is walking and Jibreel stops. The Prophet said, Jibreel. I said, ek aur baat hai. Let me ask you one more question. Some people say that Jibreel was the Prophet's tour guide. I disagree with you. What do you think? Some people say that the angel Gabriel, he was the Prophet's tour guide. I say, if he was the Prophet's tour guide, why did he go past Sidratul Muntaha then? Why did he stop there for? If he was the Prophet's tour guide, he stopped, he didn't go further. Jibreel continued, he said what? Jibreel said, Wallahi Ya Rasulullah, if I continue, I will be burnt. Beautiful point in this, which Imam Jalaluddin Rumi mentions. Imam Rumi farmate about Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. And you remember when Jibreel said, Ya Rasulullah, if I go past this, it will burn me. Ah ha ha ha. Rumi kehte, kaash Abu Bakr udhar hota hai. Subhanallah. He says, Hazrat Abu Bakr was there. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I won't look back, but I look forward. I'm willing to even sacrifice myself for you. Kitni, you know, beautiful shi'r. He said that if it was Abu Bakr, he would said, Wallahi, I'm willing to die for you, Ya Rasulullah. Burn me. Matlab kaash had changed them. Where Jibreel is, put the messenger of Allah, put Abu Bakr there, radiallahu anhu warda. He said, what? I am willing to sacrifice more for you. But remember one thing, I will never go back. I will never leave you. And then the Prophet ﷺ said that I went past Sidratul Muntaha. And Allah willed for me to see whatever He wanted me to see. He said, I went as far as seeing Al-Arsh. I saw Allah's Arsh, Allah's throne. He says the Arsh is the ceiling of paradise. The ceiling of paradise is Al-Arsh. The Prophet says Allah's throne is carried by Hamalatul Arsh. There are four that carry it. Now, on the day of judgment, eight will carry it. The Messenger of Allah said that one angel, if you were to get a bird to fly at its highest speed, and if it flew from the nose until the shoulder, it would take 700 years. Of one angel. Imagine it, one angel. From the nose until the shoulder, it takes how many years? 700 years. Subhanallah. And the Prophet said, then I saw on Al-Arsh, what did I see? I saw Allahi Mahfud wal-Qalam. I saw the sacred tablet. This is the database and the central computer of all of humanity. Everyone here, you, all of you, all of your biographies and everything you do is on this computer. The centralized place, Al-Qalam is writing. And the Prophet said from there, he said, and there's various narrations, he said, I saw Allah. I saw the Zaat of Allah. In Allah's real essence, I saw Rabb al-Izzat, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now the ulama explain this hadith in even more detail. They said, and let me share one point to you. Whenever it comes to referring to Allah, in the Quran, we never use the laws of physics to ascribe Him. So for example, we don't say Allah is in a place and time. Allah is free, like Tawqeed said. Allah is not subject to change, time or place. What we mean by this, the ulama say, was that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He took His beloved and He took him to la makan, to no place. He took him to a status or a station that has no time and has no place. As the Prophet said in Bukhari Sharif, that Allah existed and there was nothing. And Sayyidina Ali said what? When the Jew came to him, and the Jew said to him, where is your Allah? Where is your Rabb? Where is your Creator? And Ali radiallahu anhu warda wa karam Allah wajal kareem said, Kan Allahu wa la makan. Allah existed and there was no place. Wa huwa la, he said, the Jew said to him, where is your Allah now? Okay, He existed. What about now? Ali karam Allah wajal kareem. Bab al-ilm says what? He says, وَهُوَ الْآنَ عَلَيْ مَا عَلَيْكَانَ. He is now as He was before. Allah doesn't change. Allah doesn't need place or time. The ulama say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored his messenger. He took him from that place and he took him into his real essence. And the Prophet saw the real essence of Allah. Without an eye, without ears, without space, without diameters, without matter, without anything. He did not need anything, but he saw the real essence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the honor that Allah gave his messenger. The Prophet said that during the Mi'raj, or during this, he said, I saw some peoples whose lips and tongues were dripping with scissors made of fire. I saw people whose tongue and lips were dripping with the scissors were fire. I said, Ya Jibreel, O Jibreel, why is this punishment happening to them? He said, Ya Rasulullah, these are of your nation who caused fitna in their land and misguided people from the right path. He said, on this journey, I saw people who were eating rotten meat. You know, rotten meat, foul meat. He said there was nice cooked meat and there was rotten meat. And they were eating from the rotten meat. And they were not eating the right meat or the good meat. And I said, Ya Jibreel, O Jibreel, why are they doing this? And Jibreel said, Ya Rasulullah, these are of your ummat who do not earn and eat halal. Even though we've told them they can have. Can you imagine? Inshallah, Allah gave our beautiful son Taqir a lot of money in his life. Now Taqir Sahib has two options in his life. Now he's going to get £1 million if he has £1 million, inshallah, in his life. Guaranteed, he's going to get it. Now he can either do the halal or haram. He can do the halal way, having sabr, earning his money, or he can do it the quick book. Make easy money. Easy money comes and easy money, bye-bye, goes. Look at all these people now who earn haram money. Drug addicts, drug dealers. You see them driving their big cars, good easy money. And then you see them once and they'll have nothing on them. They won't even have money to feed themselves. And he said, what happened to you? He said, don't ask me, brother, I've lost everything. The taxman visited me. Her Majesty's Revenue and Customs. Allah protect us from those people. In a good way, I don't mean it in a negative way. They're doing their job. So they have nothing left. And halal. Jibreel said, what then? The Prophet said, then I saw people who were scratching their faces and were scratching their bodies. And I said, Jibreel, why are they doing this? And Jibreel said, Ya Rasulullah, they are doing that. Why? Because these were people who used to do ghiba, who used to do gossip, who would tell tales. And then the Prophet said, that on this night, I was taken to hellfire. And when I looked in hellfire, I saw every punishment in the hellfire. I saw Al-Malik, the keeper of hellfire. He is the angel who is the keeper of hellfire. The Prophet ﷺ said that since he did not smile at me. Jibreel said, Ya Rasulullah, this is Malik. He does not smile at anyone. Since the day he was created, but wallahi, if he would have smiled at anyone, it would have been you. And then the Prophet ﷺ said what? He said, and then I saw Al-Wildan Al-Mukhalladun. Al-Wildan Al-Mukhalladun. Who are these things? These are those creatures of Allah in Jannah that are neither humans nor jinn nor angels. They are neither humans nor jinn nor angels. They are very beautiful creatures of Allah and they look like pearls. You know, pearls, beautiful pearls. And their whole objective is to do your khidmat. Is to serve you. And the Prophet said, he said on Jannah, the lowest part of Jannah, the person who has the lowest part of Jannah, he said he will have 10,000 of these people serving him. And you think Her Majesty the Queen had servants? Nothing. 10,000. And then the Prophet said, what time is Maghrib? 5 minutes? I'll finish off now. And then the Prophet, he described many incidents and many issues he described. And when he came back, let me finish off with this point. So he saw all of this beauty and he came back. And when he came back to Medina Sharif, or Makkah Sharif, sorry, he told the Quraysh. Al-Quraysh said to him that you're mad. Remember, this is a miracle that happened when no one saw it. Every other miracle happened in front of people, apart from this miracle. When this miracle happened, the Prophet came back and he went to his people and said, I went here, I went this, and I did all of this. His people said, you're mad. You want me to believe you? Yani Muhammad said, oh, come on, be realistic. It takes me over a month to travel by camel from Mecca to Jerusalem, and you went overnight? Subhanallah. Ajib. They start laughing at him. They start amusing him. The ulama say that some sahaba became non-Muslim because of this. This was beyond, too much for them. Okay, this too much. The Quraysh say now, Allah, and I finish off with this point. Al-Quraysh say if we get one of them, we've got them all. All we need is one. Remember, Quraysh are planning against the Messenger of Allah. They said if we grab one of them and we convert one of them, we've got them all. They said who? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu warda. As-Siddiq. So Abu Bakr is outside Mecca. He comes back to Mecca on his journey and he sees Al-Quraysh are welcoming him. Immediately he thinks, this is a bit weird. They never welcome me. He realized something. He says, okay, what's happened? They said, ya Abu Bakr, oh Abu Bakr, subhanallah, do you know what your friend is now saying? And you know, women, you make a drama. Let's just have women, let's be offensive. Women are good people, they're all wives. Let's have people, so we don't get accusation that we are anti-gender. We love everyone, alhamdulillah. They said to him, overreacting, Abu Bakr said, okay, what's the problem? Get to the point. They said he claims to have gone from here with angels to Jerusalem. All the prophets prayed with him. Then from Jerusalem he went to Jannah and he met God. They said, mad. What do you think, Abu Bakr? What do you think? He says, in qala qal faqad sadaqt. Subhanallah. In kana qal faqad sadaqt. He said, if he said it, I believe it. Abu Bakr says, you people cannot believe and you cannot comprehend this small thing. He says, don't you know what I believe in? And I have iman that he gets wahi from the heavens in an instant. You can't believe this. This is baby stuff. This is simple. You don't believe this? This is who the Messenger of Allah is. And this is why the ulama said that this incident that happened during the Mi'raj, it is one of the great blessings and one of the great miracles. And we were given the salah, we were told prayer 5 times a day, we were given a lot of obligations, and we have attahiyatu lillahi wa salawatu. This conversation, time doesn't permit, this conversation that Allah had with His beloved. This beautiful, go and read translation of attahiyatu lillahi wa salawatu, you read your namaz. This is a direct conversation between you and Allah. Go back and look at these reasons why we read these things, and you will realize the great beauty that we have. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq to learn from the Mi'raj of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to make it part of our lives, and may we all become better people, inshallah. We will finish off with a dua, and then inshallah it will be adhan for Salatul Maghrib. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina wa Mawlana Muhammadin wa ala Ali Sayyidina wa Mawlana Muhammadin wa barik wa salli alayhi. اللهم صل على سيدنا مولانا محمد وعلى آله في الأولين وسلم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله في الآخرين وسلم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد أسعادنا نور الهدى محمد وعلى آله في كل وقت والهين وسلم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله في ملائل على إلى يوم الدين اللهم أبلغ روحا سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم مني تحية وسلاما اللهم أبلغ روحا سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم مني تحية وسلاما اللهم أبلغ روحا سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم مني تحية وسلاما اللهم انفعني بما علمتني وعلمني ما ينفعوني وزدني علما والحمد لله على كل حال اللهم نور قلوبنا بنور الإيمان Oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through the wasilah of your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we ask you to send the most honorable peace and blessings unlimitedly upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, send your most honorable blessings upon him, and through the wasilah of Habib al-Adam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, oh Allah forgive us of our sins. Oh Allah, reward every single person that has stayed in this masjid, in this masjid to do zikr with us and to do a Mi'raj al-Nabi. Oh Allah, reward every person, our brother Tokir, our small youngsters who have come here to do speeches, who are not. Oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, any mushkilat, we have removed those mushkilat from our life. Oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those people who are ill, give them shifa. Oh Allah, we have heard that our brother Ibrar, his wife is extremely ill. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us shifa. Oh Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through the wasila of Fatima to Zahra radiallahu anha, oh Allah, we ask you in the name of your Prophet to give shifa to brother Ibrar's wife. Any elderly person who has mushkilat, Allah remove the mushkilat from them. Parshana logi parshani dur farma. الہ العالمین ہمارے سارے گناہ کبیرہ صغیرہ کو معاف فرما دو. الہ العالمین ہمارا خاتم بالخیر فرما دو. الہ العالمین قیامت کا دن نبی پاک صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کی زیارت نصیب فرما. الہ العالمین جب مرتے کا وقت آئے گا کلمہ طیبہ نصیب فرما, کلمہ توحید کو نصیب فرما. الہ العالمین ہم کو سب کو نبی پاک صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کی سچی پکی محبت نصیب فرماؤ. قیامت کا دن نبی پاک صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کی شفاعت نصیب فرماؤ. او اللہ ریوارڈ آل آف اس اینڈ فورگیو آل آف اس فار اور سینز. او اللہ وٹ ایور انٹینشن وی ہیڈ فار کمنگ ٹو دس مسجد ریوارڈ اس آل دا مشکلات اینی پرسن ہیز ریموو دوز مشکلات فرام دیم. او اللہ ریوارڈ دا پیپل ہو بلڈ دس مسجد, ریوارڈ اور علماء اور مشائخ. اینڈ اللہ ہیلپ دا مسلمز ان پالستائن, کشمیر, افغانستان, عراق اینڈ پاکستان. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من أن أظلم أو أظلم أو أبغى أو يبغى عليها أو أطغى أو يطغى عليها. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من الشك والشرك الظاهر وكفي ومني وعلى. اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. يا عزيز يا غفار يا رب العالمين. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله تعالى على سيدنا مولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.